Good morning, and welcome everyone. Lovely to have you here. Please grab a seat. What a beautiful way to start off Sunday worship. And we've got lots more to come that will help us to focus our hearts and minds. But please do take a seat. Before I invite Des to come up, I want to read to you the passage in which he'll be speaking from today. And so if you have your Bibles and you would like to go with me, please look at Luke 15. We'll be looking at the passage Luke 15, the prodigal son, also known as the loving father. And perhaps you'll hear why today. Parable of the prodigal son or the loving father, chapter 15 of Luke, beginning at verse 11. And Jesus said, there was a man who had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the share of my property that will belong to me. So the father divided his property between them. A few days later, the younger son gathered all he had and traveled to a distant country. And there he squandered his property in dissolute living. When he had spent everything, a severe famine took place throughout that country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him to the fields to feed the pigs. He would gladly have filled himself with the pods that the pigs were eating, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, how many of my father's hired hands have bread enough to spare? But here I am dying of hunger. I'll get up and I'll go to my father and I'll say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me like one of your hired hands. And so he set off and went to his father. But while he was still far off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion. He ran and put his arms around him and kissed him. And the son said to the father, Father, I've sinned against heaven and before you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his slaves, quickly bring out his robe, the best one, and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Get the fatted calf, kill it, let us eat and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And so they began to celebrate. I got to meet Des when we were talking about doing a radio interview. And I couldn't really understand what he was saying, you know, where he's from, but you'll find out this. But, you know, before all the translations, we eventually worked out what he was saying. We had a good conversation, and he's just been an absolute blessing. And he came and spoke to our men's group, and just was so wonderful to hear his journey, to hear how the Lord has used him. And so I pray that you will be blessed as he comes and shares from the Word, shares what he's been doing, but also shares some insights to help not only the men here today and those who may be watching, but also how do we get to be the role models of that same extreme love that we heard about today, and something also for many of the women in our lives as well, as to what would the Lord be saying to you. And so would you please give a round of applause as we invite Des to come and speak.
Thank you, man. Thank you so much. I'm sorry about my accent. I've sort of had it all my life. Wouldn't you believe? Actually, I do radio, and I hate my accent. When I hear myself played back, I go, ooh, oh, how have I been had such a disadvantage? Yeah, whatever. So listen, thanks very much for the opportunity to come along and talk. Thank you, Reverend Dan, for the opportunity to talk into the lives of not only men on Father's Day, but also mothers, grandfathers, grandmothers. And he told me I can speak for 90 minutes, so I hope you're all happy with the 90 minutes, yeah? Believe me, after 20 minutes, you'll say, I've had enough. Yeah, I don't need any more. But listen, I really do appreciate the opportunity to come along and talk to you folks. You know, the prodigal son's an amazing story. Somebody once wrote, the tender image of this young man's anxious and faithful father, running to meet him and showering him with kisses, is one of the most moving and compassionate scenes in the whole Holy Scripture. It tells everybody, wayward or otherwise, how much God wants us back in the protection of his arms, how much God loves us. And I want to say a few things to men right up front. Firstly, a fundamentally happy childhood with a mum and dad gives you the feeling that you're actually worth being around. Your ego is nurtured, and all that happens without you even knowing about it. So the role of mums and dads in a relationship is so key to a happy family. And young people here, remember that whenever you start to have a family. You know, it's so, so key. Children want their fathers to be proud of them. And an involved father promotes inner growth, strength, confidence. Studies have shown that when fathers are affectionate, are supportive towards their kids, it greatly affects a child's cognitive and social development and provides an overall sense of well-being and confidence. You know, I deal a lot with men all around Australia, in fact, all around the world. And the one thing I have never heard is a man regretting the amount of time that he spent with his kids. The opposite is true. There's so many men who get, and I'm one of them, who get to the end of their life and they say, I wish I had spent more time with my kids. I was not a good dad. And I got 3 phone calls this morning that I was so blessed that my children actually wanted to wish me Father's Day. And so I don't deserve it. I never deserved it. But, you know, you learn from the lessons, hopefully. So it's got nothing to do with money. It's got nothing to do with how much you make. It's about how you impact your kids. You know, the man before you, this humble little man here, I'm actually a prodigal son. Truthfully, I'm a prodigal son. I grew up in Ireland, in Belfast, and my mum and dad were very godly people. My dad was a preacher. My brother was a Baptist pastor. And I was truly the prodigal son. And in 1981, I left Ireland and came to Australia for a different life. I didn't want the life that I had. I wanted the high life. I wanted the good life. And so, let's say I ran away. I went into the corporate world. I had executive jobs with Qantas and NRMA and big organizations like that. And, you know, I never, ever thought about godly things. I never thought about Christianity. But that all changed in March of 2011, 12 years ago, when I committed my life to the Lord. On the side of the Stuart Highway, just south of Catherine in the Northern Territory, I surrendered my life to Jesus. Not for a safer life, not for a wealthier life, but for a more fulfilled life. A changed life, hopefully a godly life, but certainly a different life. I got involved in the kingdom, which is so, so important. And God led me into men's ministry, and I've been in men's ministry ever since. I ran men's groups in Queensland, Southeast Queensland, 63 men's groups, doing all sorts of things like fishing and golf and all the things that men love to do, but they just do it together and do it in a godly way. Now I lead a ministry which is called Momentum. Momentum is a ministry for men, helping men to do life better. How to be better dads? How to be better husbands? How to be better friends? How to be better people in the workplace, all around us? And some may recognize my accent because I actually do a radio show on Rima, which is called Delving with Des. So Wednesdays, 1 o'clock, tune in. You'll hear my dulcet tones. So just to talk briefly about Momentum, it was founded in Port Macquarie, believe it or not. I spoke with Werner, who's the general manager of Rima here in town, and he asked me to do a radio show for men in Port Macquarie. That has morphed into a ministry that is broadcast every week to 37 radio stations all around Australia. It's on Vision Radio, which is 780 odd stations. 45 countries around the world take the podcast. And we've just signed an agreement, about to sign an agreement with an organization called Re-Up Men, which is all about discipleship for men, based in a place called Bowling Green, Kentucky. Isn't that a great name? Bowling Green, Kentucky. And they have, their outreach reaches tens of thousands of men all around the U.S. And God has blessed us in that we're going to have all our podcasts available to those tens of thousands of men in the U.S. Just absolutely amazing. We are really, really, really so blessed. But I just want to briefly talk about the statistics around men's groups and why they're important. 85% of men who go to men's groups experience positive change in their role as a father. They experience positive change in the relationship with their kids and how they can talk to their kids. They have a positive change in their knowledge about their children's development because they're actually interested. 63% are satisfied with being in a men's group, which is, I guess, sort of good. 70% are more comfortable about visiting their children's school. You'll think they would do that automatically, but actually men have to learn to do some of these things. It doesn't necessarily come automatically. And 75% have more conversations with their kids. So I asked the men here, how many of you guys are in men's groups? How many of you take the time to mix with other men? And more importantly, when you do mix with other men, is there one man in your world that you can talk to when things go pear-shaped? If you haven't created those relationships with other men where you can be, where you can confide with them, you can open with them and talk about things in your world, it's impossible to do when the things happen in your world. And whether, you know, the statistics around pornography are huge. Something like 60% of pastors in America either are involved in pornography or struggle with pornography. 60% of pastors. Now, you equate that to men, it's 70, 80% of men either watch pornography on a regular basis. You know, it's awful, the influence of pornography and availability of pornography. So I encourage you, men, just to reach out to the men's group, get into small groups, find somebody who you can be open and honest with. Because you go to a mixed group, men won't talk openly about their world in a mixed group. You know, they won't talk about pornography. They won't talk about addiction. They won't talk about masturbation. They won't talk about the things that they really need to talk about openly and deal with in their lives. So now I'm going to go on to the story of the prodigal son. You've been waiting for that, right? So, you know, there's some clear messages for us in the message of the prodigal son. You know, the father was so many things, and I look back at my father, who was such a godly man I admired and loved all my life. But he was so represented these things I'm going to talk about. And the first one is patient. You know, it's so easy for fathers to get caught up in their world at the expense of being patient with their children. You know, the son was gone for a long time. In my case, I was away from Ireland 30 years before I became a Christian. But the father waited expectantly every day looking for his son. Is my son going to come home today? Is my son going to come home tomorrow? You know, I mean, just, it's amazing. And as I said before, my dad prayed, my mom and dad prayed for me for 58 years before I came to Christ. It's just like, wow, what such faithfulness. And the father remembers that despite what they, fathers remember that despite what they say, our kids still have so much to learn and watch, and they watch everything we do. So I encourage you just to think about that when you're with your kids. So dads, how patient are you with your kids? Are you patient with your kids? I wasn't patient with my kids. I was aggressive with them, and I wanted them to do everything I told them. But, you know, at Momentum, I can tell you that there's so many men talk to me about they wish they had spent more time with their kids. You know, they spend quality time with the kids, talking to them, reading to them, and so forth. It's just all over the place. So what lessons can we take from the father's patience with his sons? The first lesson is take all the time you can to be proactive with your kids. Take all the time. Wait for them to catch up with you. Those things are so, so important. But secondly, the father was loving. There's no shame in a father showing love towards his children. You know, the father's actions demonstrated his love. He watched out every day. It was in his mind as a top priority, waiting for his son to come home. His father ran to him. You know, and that's an amazing thing about the Middle East and Middle Eastern culture. Running is considered shameful. And so this guy was a nobleman. He had property, he had all these things. And yet he pulled up his robes and he ran to meet his son. Right? Absolutely taboo in their culture. It'd be like somebody in Port Macquarie, father, run to get his son in Clarence Street with his boxer shorts on, running down to meet his son. Now, it's that sort of analogy. It's just not antisocial, but unsociable, I guess. So, but the father knew that his son coming into the town, he could be beaten, he could be humiliated, and shamed because of the way he'd shamed his family. And he didn't want that to happen to his son he loved. So what did he do? He took upon himself, he ripped up his robe, and he ran to his son. And he hugged him, and he kissed him. And that act alone saved his son, you know, from being beaten up or whatever, humiliated for the way he'd treated his family. So what he didn't do was say, "What did you do that for? You were stupid and never listened. I told you so. I hope you've learned your lesson." Yeah, I've had a dollar for every time I said those phrases to my kids. I wouldn't ever have to work again. But the son was probably ashamed to return expecting rebuke and respecting shame, but the love of his father removed the fear. You know, 1 Peter 4:8 says, "And above all things, have fervent love for one another, for love will cover a multitude of sins." So what lessons do we learn from the father's love? Always be thinking about the words and actions around our kids. Think about what we're saying. Think about what we're doing when we're talking to our kids. Be loving in everything you do. You know, you can be disciplining your kids in love. Those aren't opposite ends of the spectrum. They're on the same spectrum. And so be loving when you do that. But also things like I work from like 8 in the morning to 8 o'clock at night in the corporate world. I was never at home for my kids. Never. You know, and so they lost out in kicking a football or reading books before they went to bed or whatever it was. They missed out on that, and that's shameful for me. The third thing the father was forgiving. What a great thing. I mean, our Heavenly Father forgives us lots. So always be ready to forgive your kids. And remember the indiscretions no more. So it's not a matter of, "I'll forgive you, but I'm going to remind you of that tomorrow or the next day or whatever." Yeah, it's really forgiving them. So the son was ready to become a servant, but his father stopped him once he had repented and said he was sorry. How often do we expect our kids to say sorry, and then we go on and tell them how bad they were? Dads, just let's focus on not the wrong that's been done, but rather on the joy of repentance. That is the key. And avoid the ongoing sorrow. So what are the lessons from forgiving? Dads, always be ready to forgive your kids. Don't judge your children by your standards, but rather coach them to those standards. And the last thing I want to talk about is the priorities, getting the right priorities. Here, this father put his kids, his son, at the highest priority. Every day, he looked for his son, waited for his son to come home, was ready there to give him a hug and get the robe and all the things that he was given. You know, his father had the right priorities. So it was not important that the son had sinned or that he'd wasted his wealth or the pain that he even caused his father, but that he was home where he belonged. Stuff can be replaced, sorrows and sins can be forgiven, but much harder to repair and restore a soul. As Mark says in 8:36, "For what shall a profit of man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul?" So men, what are your priorities? Are your priorities your kids? Are your priorities seeing them grow up in a godly way? Or is it in everything else around you, your business, your hobbies, or whatever they happen to be? It's never too late, by the way. I still have a relationship with my kids, even though they have now kids of their own. I can sow into my three boys. And while they're not Christians yet, I'm praying that they will become so. So the lessons to be learned, dads, what are your priorities towards your kids? You know, there's a guy called Richard Fay who was a Baptist pastor, is a Baptist pastor in Brisbane. And Richard's a great, great guy who comes on to our Momentum show regularly. But Richard was in the IT world, and he was doing stuff in the IT. And in the IT world, you work long, long hours. And he made this conscious decision at one point that he was going to leave work at 5 o'clock every day. And so he went to his boss and said, 5 o'clock, I'm leaving. And his boss gave him grief. But you know, within a short space of time, not only was he leaving at 5 o'clock, but all the other dads left at 5 o'clock. What a great testimony and witness to the family and the importance of family. It's really so important. Now, the ladies who are here today, you thought you were going to get off, right? You thought you were going to get off scot-free. Not true. So, you know, there's some things that wives and mothers can do that will facilitate what is happening in the dad's world. Simple things. One is validate the father's role in the household, right? Treat him properly. He's not a second-class citizen. You might think he's a second-class citizen, but don't treat him like a second-class citizen. He really has a role to play in the family. Work on your marriage both together. Don't do negative stuff in front of the kids. Take that stuff offside. Let the kids see a loving, respected relationship that they can look at and admire and want to emulate when they get older. Appreciate what he does rather than focus on what he doesn't do. And I'm preaching to the converted here, right? So honor each other in front of the kids. Make room for his way of doing things. It'll not be your way necessarily, but honor what he does. Encourage him to stay refreshed by mixing with mates and getting out and doing things that he needs to do as a man. Give him time alone with his kids, to bond with his kids. And make time for him to do reading and all the sort of things that you do as a father for the kids. So, you know, we're blessed to have a heavenly father. We're blessed to have a father in heaven who will look at, you know, somebody like me after 58 years and say, you know what, I love you. I want you to belong to me. And through a journey I went on, on the Stuart Highway, I committed my life to Jesus. The best decision I certainly ever made in my life. But if there's anybody here who hasn't experienced that and hasn't put their faith in God, please, listen to me, you've got to do that. You've got to accept your role as a sinner, accept that Jesus has died for you, and put your faith in Christ. It is the best thing you will do, not only for eternity, but even in this life. You'll live a fulfilled and encouraged life in this world, and you'll serve others and do what you can do. So I just pray that even if you want to talk to me after the service, if that's on your heart, please just come and talk to me. Talk to Pastor Dan, any of the folk here, any of the leadership, they'd love to chat to you if that's something that's on your heart. So thank you for your time. Don't forget to be a good dad or a good mum. And thank you for allowing me to come and talk to you today. Thank you.
Before you go, I'd love to be able to say a prayer for you. And one of the things I want to encourage is, as someone who didn't grow up with a dad in the picture, it was really the men in my church who were my grandfather and father figures, the role model. So I am a product of that blessing. Mm-hmm. So, and this is why I actually like the title, not just Reverend Dan, but Father Dan, simply because it's a reminder for me to be that fatherly role model. To others, I'm blessed with my children, my boys. I'm absolutely blown away at the men that they've become, but I'm still intentional about the young men and women, but young men that are around me, to speak into them. And I want to encourage you, regardless of your age, whether in your 30s, 40s, 50s, so on, please be intentional about gathering our young men under your wing. You never know where they may end up. Let's pray for Des. So Lord, I just thank you for the blessing Des has been to us this day, and we pray that his words that you've spoken into him to speak to us would resonate in our hearts and minds. Help us not to just think about them, but to be able to process and then enact on them, that we may be the fathers and mothers, but fathers today that we're focusing on, that you have called us to be for our children, our grandchildren, our great-grandchildren, and for the young men that you've placed around us. But I pray your blessings to be upon Des as he works in momentum and delving with Des, that he consistently be a blessing to those that you place before him. This we pray in Jesus' name. We all said,
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.